Born in the year 1694 in a town just north of the port city of Genoa, Paul Denis was destined to proclaim the mystery of the cross and the passion of Jesus Christ. Of a devout Catholic family of numerous siblings, life in Italy in the 1700s was marked by the effects of the Protestant Reformation, Enlightenment, and anti-ecclesial Freemasonic groups that continued to revolt against the authority of the Church's magisterium and defiantly assert the supremacy of reason over faith and its source found in divine revelation. Paul was fueled with the ambitions of a young man who was going to offer his life in martyrdom to oppose the Ottoman Empire and Islamic encroachment into the Adriatic Peninsula. The already religiously fervent young Paul Danet was scandalized by the morale and vices of his fellow soldiers. In the city of Crema, on his way to Venice to get ready for deployment, Paul stepped into a church to pray before the Blessed Sacrament. At that pivotal time, God revealed to him how he was to enter into and fight a battle on the spiritual front by impressing upon his heart a love for Christ crucified. Subsequently, upon returning home, his vocation matured through further prayer, solitude, and penance. He and his younger brother held the conviction that they were called to holiness and heroism. From their makeshift retreat house on the small island of Argentario, they set off for the Vatican for approval of their upstart fraternity and to serve the sick and poor in one of Rome's hospitals. The genuineness and integrity of their witness got them noticed, and they were encouraged to study for the priesthood. Convinced of their calling to preach missions, they started attracting other young men into their newly formed Passionist community. For the next 50 years of his life, St. Paul of the Cross would know all the trials, difficulties, and consolations of founding a new religious congregation. In the thousands of letters he wrote to those seeking his counsel, he speaks of the constant conflict in his preaching missions from those in the world who opposed the gospel, and from those within the church who were suspicious or threatened by his intrusion into the competitive terrain of shrinking and scarce resources. The sufferings and setbacks served to purify and strengthen his proclamation of the mystery of the cross. He died in the year 1775, with monasteries and a convent both for men and women religious firmly established throughout the Italian landscape. His tomb is venerated in the Roman Basilica of Saints John and Paul on the Caelian Hill overlooking the Colosseum. Rightfully then, we turn to a master whose life's work focused on the preaching of the cross. In our current time of crisis, we turn to the Via Crucis and let the words of St. Paul the Cross stir us, challenge us, confront us, and guide us into the mystery of redemption. For example, from one telling episode of his life, Paul was undergoing persecution and humiliation from many false accusations. He preached a mission where only a few of the faithful attended, and he encountered much resistance. During his final sermon, Father Paul spoke directly to those who were glad to get rid of him. He warned them, "I shall leave behind me one who shall preach better than I." Then he pointed to the crucifix. "After I am gone, this crucifix will preach the mission for me." The holy priest then walked out of the church, and the crucifix began to bleed from his hands, feet, and side. People rushed after Father Paul to tell him about the miracle, but he only answered, "Ma questo già lo sapevo." That, I knew it already. Those who had refused to listen to him during the mission were converted by this wonderful miracle. And so, we begin on this way of the cross with the trial-tested insights of St. Paul. What an honor God confers on us when he calls us to travel the same road as his divine Son. First station, Jesus is condemned to death. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Considering the mockery of a trial before the Sanhedrin, the false charges brought before Pilate, the momentum shift of public opinion crying out for crucifixion, the blindness and cruelty of a justice system that pronounces a guilty sentence and deserving of extermination, how can we not recognize all the same disturbing parallels in our own day? To make sense of the apathy, chaos, and malice before us, St. Paul of the Cross wrote, "Ah, poor world, what a sad state you are in. How many evils drown you, faith grown cold, piety frosted over and crushed to the earth. Woe, woe, what scourges are to be feared." The Holy Gospel tells us that unless the grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains but a single grain and does not bear fruit. But the poor grain, by being sown, how much must it not suffer to die and fructify? It must endure rain, snow, wind, and sun. The soul is a seed that God sows in the field of Holy Church. To fructify, it must die blow by blow of pain, contradiction, and persecution. Second station, Jesus takes up his cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. We read in the Gospels that Jesus requires that we take up our cross daily, that it would do us no good to gain the whole world and suffer the loss of our souls. Confronting our timidity, indifference, disdain, and doubts, we need constant encouragement in the midst of our difficulties. Accordingly, then, St. Paul advises, the greater our cross, the greater is our gain. The more deprived suffering is of consolation, the purer it is. The more creatures are against us, the more closely united are we to God. Meditation on Jesus Christ crucified is a precious balm which sweetens all our pains. St. Paul, writing to an acquaintance who is seeking counsel in the midst of her infirmity, provides this exhortation. There could not be a surer sign of God's love for you than this pain which he has sent you. Adore the divine will. You were in good health when you were in the world, but you were not then as dear to God as you are now. He loves you as a daughter, as a cherished spouse. This is why he treats you so generously. Long illnesses are the greatest favors that God confers on souls whom he loves most. Repose peacefully in the arms of your heavenly spouse, who loves you much. Hold yourself on the cross of sickness as tranquilly and silently as is possible. If the cause of your illness be the wound of divine love which embalms your soul, it is well if you die under such a stroke. yours will be a death more precious than life. Third station, Jesus falls the first time. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. In contemplating the first fall, shame breaks through the wall I have interiorly constructed around it. As fortified a defense I thought I built, I must deal with the reality of my guilt and the embarrassment that it causes me. I relive continually the weakness of my resistance in the face of temptation, and now I am burdened by the consequences of my own fall. I am disheartened. I need a teacher. St. Paul of the Cross instructs, "Let us desire nothing so much as the good pleasure of God. As soon as we know the will of God, we ought to follow it without delay. When our pious undertakings meet with little success, let us not be troubled. When God wills anything to be done for His glory, He will not fail to urge on the work until it is accomplished." Fourth station, Jesus meets his afflicted mother. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Catholic tradition is compellingly clear in advising the faithful Christian to foster and cultivate a deep devotion to our Blessed Mother. Simeon had prophesied that the sword of sorrow would pierce her soul and that the secret thoughts of many would be laid bare. As conflict escalates in the Passion of Jesus and the persecution of His Church, we know that the supernatural perseverance of our Blessed Mother is admirable. Her assistance is crucial in following her Son to the cross. This accompaniment was made clear to St. Paul early in his vocation, as the following story attests. One day in the summer of 1720, St. Paul was returning home after having been to Holy Communion in the Church of the Capuchins, when he had the following vision. He was wrapped up in ecstasy and saw himself clothed in a long black tunic with a white cross upon the breast of it, and the sacred name of Jesus in white letters written under it. He heard an interior locution, and the voice said, "This is to signify how pure and spotless should be the heart which bears engraven upon it the sacred name of Jesus." Shortly after, when engaged in prayer, he saw the Blessed Virgin, who showed to him a long black tunic with a white cross upon the breast of it, with the same words, "Jesu Passio," which means the Passion of Jesus Christ. Paul wrote out a full account of those visions and gave it to the bishop, who simply looked at it and was silent. The saint, unsure of himself because of the bishop's silence, began to hesitate a little wondering as to whether he might not have been deluded, when again the Blessed Virgin appeared to him in the same black habit with the badge upon it, exactly as the Passionists wear it to the present day. She said, "My son, you see that I am clothed in mourning. This is because of the sorrowful passion of my son Jesus. Therefore, you are to be clothed likewise, and are to found a congregation in which the members will be also clothed in the same manner, and they are to mourn continually for the passion and death of my dear son." Fifth station, Simon of Cyrene helps to carry the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Most commentaries of Simon present him as one who is initially hesitant and resistant in being forced to help carry the cross. Slowly, upon seeing the unjust and barbaric treatment of the one who bore it so patiently, Simon's acceptance of this heavy burden changes. Clearly, we know that we are in need of the same infusion of grace in reconciling ourselves to the crosses we are meant to carry. And so, the resolve of St. Paul is what we need now. Believe me, afflictions, fears, desolations, dryness, abandonment, temptations, and other persecutions make an excellent broom, which sweeps from your soul all the dust of hidden imperfections. On one occasion, he shared an experience of powerful mystical intimacy. While meditating on the Passion of Jesus, he remained in prayer at the foot of a large crucifix. He said to the Lord, "Lord, hide me in your wounds, because I cannot stand before others without giving way to sorrow." Then the most holy crucifix before which I was praying detached his arm from the cross and embraced me closely, very closely, and put me in his most holy side, where he held me for 3 hours, and it seemed to me that I was in paradise. In your pains and trials say, "May thy holy will be done, O my God. I welcome thee, afflictions, beloved sufferings. I press you to my heart. Ah, dear hand of my God, I bless thee. Blessed be the holy rod that strikes me with so much love. O tender Father, it is good for me to be humbled." Sixth station, Veronica wipes the face of Jesus. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. The account of the imprint of Jesus' face, thanks to the kindness of the woman, though without gospel testimony, helps preserve Jesus' promise that, "For whosoever shall give you to drink a cup of water in my name, because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, he shall not lose his reward." The Church has in her treasury safely kept the true images of Christ's face. While Jesus left no manuscripts of his words, both the Shroud of Turin and the Holy Linen of Manapello left behind in the tomb present a stunning and wonderful mystery for the Church to marvel upon. St. Paul of the Cross offers this account, written to an acquaintance, of being imprinted with our Lord's favor. One day he confided to me in deepest secrecy that one Good Friday, while he was at prayer before the Holy Sepulchre, that Jesus deigned to stamp and impress on his heart his most holy passion. 3 of his ribs near the heart raised. If they had not been raised, he said to me, I could not have endured it or stayed alive. All the instruments of his passion were carved in my heart, and in the midst was the most holy sign, the passion of Jesus Christ. Along with his own passion, he printed on my heart the sorrows of his dear mother. Daughter, he said to me, oh, what sorrows I experienced, oh, what love, a mixture of extreme pain and excessive love. He further adds, I wish that all men could understand the great favor that God grants them when, in his goodness, he sends them suffering, and especially suffering devoid of all consolation. For then the soul, like gold which is purified in the fiery crucible, is cleansed, made beautiful, detached from earthly things, and united to the sovereign good, without even being conscious of it. Seventh station, the second fall. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. For every fall we experience, the familiar accusatory voice roars within us. I knew that it was wrong. I knew that it would do me harm and hurt others. I have no one but myself to blame. And more still, I have a long and arduous road ahead of me. When caught in such a vicious cycle, I need to remember that I am not to be defined by the worst of my sins, but my identity is to be found in my baptism. We need to be mentored so as not to give up. St. Paul of the Cross shared with a close confidant regarding a troubling incident he was undergoing. Do not be troubled because people despise and ignore me. God permits this trial to humble me, and I rejoice in it. I know not what I have done to this prelate. I only know that I labored for a long time in his diocese, and that had I remained there, I would have died. But the poor bishop merits sympathy, for persecutors and calumniators have not been lacking, especially since the question of establishing a retreat was broached. God be blessed. My trial does not trouble me. I intended to write to the bishop, but I am not equal to the task. It is much better to leave my justification to God. Love your enemies in Christ. Show them the sweetest cordiality. At the same time, make some interior act of love, as, for instance, O dear souls of Jesus, I love you in the heart of Jesus, which burns with love for you. O blessed souls, love Jesus for me. Eighth station, Jesus meets the women of Jerusalem. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. This scene in the midst of your agony presents a twofold mystery. On the one hand, you receive the kind sentiments of the women who felt a deep pity for you. On the other hand, you offer a chilling and grave warning. For if in the green wood they do these things, what shall be done in the dry? The praying of the Via Crucis is a continual invitation to worship you in the sufferings you bore for our salvation, and a begging for the grace to be ready to bear the crosses that await us. St. Paul prepares us for this twofold mystery so that we may not be intimidated and overwhelmed by the cross. In his diary, St. Paul writes, "At Holy Communion I had much sweetness. My dear God gave me infused knowledge of the joy which the soul will have when we see him face to face, when it will be united with him in holy love. Then I felt sorrow to see him offended, and I told him that I would willingly be torn to pieces for a single soul. Indeed, I felt that I would die when I saw the loss of so many souls who do not experience the fruit of the Passion of Jesus." Ninth station, the third fall. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Truthfully, we know that relying merely on our own coping skills, we cannot continue on this lifelong journey of the cross. Our dependency upon Jesus is clear. The spiritual battle, though very much unfolding all around us, begins within us and in our finding the willingness to persevere along the way. So much is at stake. Once again, St. Paul of the Cross, a master in the spiritual life, offers insight upon the battle being waged. A companion of his describes the otherwise hidden life of the saint. The devil, angered by the loss of so many of his subjects, seemed to declare open war upon Paul. On many occasions throughout Paul's life, he was fiercely assaulted by the devils. God allowed this, it seems, for two reasons. Firstly, to test and purify Paul, thereby increasing his union with God. And secondly, for all those who were edified and drawn into a deeper holiness by witnessing Paul's triumph over the demons, always through the grace of God. On many occasions in the morning, his companions would find him red and bruised all over his body, as if he had been beaten from head to foot. At other times, the demons sought to disrupt his prayer life by making strange noises in his room in an effort to disrupt his prayers or his sleeping. He stated that off and on, the demons would appear to him under dreadful forms and knock the furniture about in his room, in which screeches like cats and grunts like pigs howled in an infernal concert aimed at distracting and discouraging him. In his own words, St. Paul teaches, "Remember that true holiness is accompanied by pains and tribulations from within and without, by attacks of visible and invisible enemies, by trials of body and mind, and desolations and prolonged dryness. And all that will live in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." That is to say, all sorts of trials from demons, from men, and from our rebellious flesh. If our salvation depended only on ourselves, we should have much to fear. But as it is in the hands of God, we can tranquilly repose in him. He that rises after his falls with confidence in God and profound humility of heart will become, in God's hands, a proper instrument for the accomplishment of great things. But he who acts otherwise can never do any good. Let us never despair of the divine help. We would thereby do a serious injustice to the Father of Mercies. Tenth station, Jesus is stripped of his garments. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. This episode, like the crowning with thorns, clearly is intended to humiliate. Moreover, this station typically confronts our conscience in regards to sins against purity. The very word chastisement has everything to do with how ready we are to face the intensity of encounter with God at the time of our final judgment. The thought of a chastisement, the making aware and known the privacy and secrecy of our sins, causes us to be anxious and apprehensive, much like the bewildered and distressed apostles around the table at the Last Supper. One of you is about to betray me. Surely not I, Lord. St. Paul of the Cross offers this wise and holy perspective. The least grain of pride is sufficient to overturn a mountain of holiness. Allow yourself, therefore, to be penetrated by a deep sense of your own misery. Be dead to all that is not God. Keep yourself detached from every creature in perfect interior solitude. All this will be easy to you if you make yourself little, for God loves childlike souls and teaches them that exalted wisdom which is hidden from the wise of this world. Though I find myself in so wretched a condition that I feel as if I no longer possess faith, hope, or charity, nor even that natural light with which other men enjoy, so that I seem like an animal, even then, were I asked of what I was thinking, I could truthfully say that in the depths of my soul, I have God alone present with me. Eleventh station, Jesus is nailed to the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. Of all the stations, Jesus being nailed to the cross screams out an unimaginable and excruciating torture. From one meditation upon this mystery, an inspired writer infers that the nails were like bombs bursting of searing pain. How unprepared and afraid I am to suffer pain. I am no masochist. I have no way of physically training for the threat of physical violence as the supreme cost of faithful discipleship. The martyrs throughout history are evidence that I must be willing to accept even so high a price so as to remain faithful. We need help. St. Paul of the Cross exhorts. We must persuade ourselves that we are nothing, that we can do nothing, that we know nothing. To have nothing, to be able to do nothing, to know nothing, and God will cause to spring forth from this nothingness the work of His greatest glory. Far from consoling me, the things of this world inspire me with pain and disgust. It seems to me that I am waiting 1,000 years the happiness of going to my God, my supreme good. The soul, once in paradise, will be transformed into God, and God will be all in the soul, in such a manner that the soul will be, as it were, deified. Cast a drop of sweet water into the sea. It will be so absorbed that we can no longer distinguish it. So in heaven, the beatified spirit, which is immersed in the immense ocean of the divinity, is in a certain sense deified by being united through love to God. Do you know why God subjects you to so many miseries? That He may bestow on you the riches of heaven.
Dies ire, dies illa, salve seclum in favilla, teste.
12th station, Jesus dies on the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. The divine reproaches of Good Friday, based upon a passage from the prophet Micah, confront us with the staggering indictment, O my people, what have I done to you? How have I offended you? Answer me. What response can be given except to hang one's head in contrition and repentance? As experts will explain, the cause of death, in addition to the enormity of trauma that our Lord's body endured, was a slow asphyxiation. The horror of trying to balance the forward pending weight of his body upon the nailed wounds while his lungs gradually filled with fluid eventually led to his suffocation. And the piercing of his side and the ensuing flow of blood and water points to this reality. Truly, O Lord, you have laid down your life in love. Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us and on the whole world. St. Paul of the Cross understands well the power of the crucifixion. O souls, seek a refuge like pure doves in the shadow of the crucifix. There mourn the passion of your divine spouse, and drawing from your hearts flames of love and rivers of tears, make of them a precious balm with which to anoint the wounds of your Savior. When you attain true humility of heart and self-contempt, ask leave of Jesus to enter His divine heart, and you will at once obtain it. Place yourself as a victim on that altar Where the fire of divine love is ever burning, let the sacred flame burn you to the marrow of your bones. Then, if the breath of the Holy Spirit raise you to the contemplation of the divine mysteries, leave to your soul the liberty of losing itself in this holy contemplation. Oh, how pleasing to God is this practice!
Ante diem rationis, in gemis quotam quam reus, culpa rubes vultus meus, supplicanti parce teus, qui Maria absolvisti, et latro.
13th station. Jesus is taken down from the cross. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. St. Paul of the Cross, as one who preached the Passion, was able to move hearts and consciences to deeply appreciate the immensity of grace offered in the mystery of our salvation. At the core of his proclamation was the exhortation to love Jesus with the heart of Mary, and in turn, to love Mary with the heart of Jesus. Those who carried on this Passionist mission were intended to keep alive the love of Jesus Christ, who came to save us from sin at great cost to himself. Most notably, St. Gabriel of the Sorrowful Virgin and St. Gemma Galgani, in their own way, extended the victory of Christ crucified and the queenship of Our Lady of Sorrows. Upon reflecting on this mystery of the Pietà, St. Paul of the Cross shares, I asked the Most Holy Mother that she would let me know what had occasioned the greatest martyrdom for her at the time of the Passion of her Son. She answered me that the greatest pain that pierced her heart was to hear Jesus accused of leading people astray, and herself reproached as if she had not given him a good upbringing. My heart breaks when I think of the sorrows of the Most Holy Virgin. O tender Mother, unutterable was thy grief in finding thyself deprived of your dear Son, and then in beholding him dead in thy arms. Ah, who can realize the sadness of Mary when she returned to Bethany after the burial of her Son? Jesus expires on the cross. He is dead that we may have life. All creation mourns. The sun darkens, the earth trembles, the rocks burst, and the veil of the temple is rent in two. My heart alone remains harder than a rock. Fourteenth station. Jesus is laid in the tomb. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. The death of God and his silence speaks to the experience of so many in our contemporary world and our time of crises. The disordered ideologies of our day that promote a culture of death with its obsession with abortion, redefined marriages, misdirected education of children, gender distortion, dubious pandemic protocols, questionable vaccine mandates, addictions, overdoses, and suicides. These are the tragic results of the willful choice to eclipse the revelation and truth of Jesus Christ. Rather than despair, we entrust these troubling realities to our crucified Savior. We are called to bear witness to the full Paschal mystery. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. He will judge the living and the dead. He reigns now as King already. We are to invoke the help of heaven in giving testimony to this saving truth and push back against the forces of darkness. St. Paul of the Cross pleads, if you correspond to the designs of God, He will make a saint of you. Be generous and remember that we ought to walk in the footsteps of Jesus crucified. The servant of God who is not crucified with Jesus Christ, what is he? He is unworthy of divine contemplation who has not fought and conquered some great temptation. God has suffered much for me. Ought I not suffer something for him? One of the best proofs that we advance in virtue is to be at peace amid the attacks and the contradictions of creatures. Be firm on this point and despise all the assaults of hell. More than ever, show your fidelity to God by reposing on the cross with equanimity of spirit and even exteriorly be calm and serene without murmur or complaint. Drink of the chalice which Jesus himself offers you. If it be bitter to the palate, it is sweet to the heart. Pray for our poor congregation whose mission it is to mourn without ceasing the sorrows and the death of our beloved Redeemer. God wishes it to produce a great number of good laborers who, as trumpeters of the Holy Ghost, will preach to the world and destroy sin. St. Paul of the Cross and his final spiritual testimony. This, my dearly beloved brethren, is that which I wish with all the love of my poor heart from you who are present, from the others who wear this habit of penance and mourning in the memory of the passion and death of our beloved Redeemer, and from those who will in the future be called to this little flock of Jesus Christ, I recommend to all, and especially the superiors, continually to persevere and foster in the congregation the spirit of prayer, the spirit of solitude, and the spirit of poverty. Be certain that if these three things are maintained, the congregation shall shine as the sun in the sight of God and men. Try to labor as much as possible for the good of Holy Church, for the salvation of poor souls, by missions, spiritual exercises, and other works according to our institute, promoting in all hearts devotion to the Passion of Jesus Christ and the sorrows of Mary. May the Passion of Jesus Christ be ever in our hearts. Amen.